The reason the band stayed together for 31 or whatever the number of years is because everybody's different.
Well, basically, we all get on very well together. Now, some people mightn't think that when they watch where we book into hotels.
We stay apart from each other as long, as much as possible, to the extent of, if we can manage it, separate floors on hotels, you know.
We don't sit beside each other. And it's very funny because sometimes at breakfast or that, you could see four chieftains down at breakfast all in separate corners of the restaurant hidden behind newspapers, you know.
It's in families where you get one brother or a child and parent that are so like each other that they're fighting all the time. That's what breaks things up.
When we get off that plane in Dublin Airport, that's it, we're gone. We don't see each other anymore until the next tour.
We just keep our own space. And that's why we're still here after 30 years.
If people forge their own path and they're different, then not only do they stay together because of that difference, because difference attracts, but sameness repels.
And it works out because in the evenings when you come into the dressing room, we can have a bit of crack and enjoy each other's company then.
When I played him the song, he thought it was great, that's the song. I remember sitting down in Los Angeles in December, we were doing a tour, and he said, sure, you know. He took away the tape. But when we got into the studio, it became quite a different thing with the whole band, and the freestyle sort of rhythms that I had heard and was going to do it in sort of didn't fit in with his guitar playing and how he wanted to sing it. So we were getting into deep water or something, out to the jacks. That's where I always go for, just for a split second, you get fresh ideas. And I was thinking about the song, and I, in my mind, you know, this guy went away sailing on a boat or something like that and went to Malabar, and you get your own interpretation of how the song came about, some Irish guy. And I decided, you know, South Sea Islands, that kind of feel. I'd put a calypso, boom, da-dum, da-da-dum, and put that sort of rhythm into it, and sort of went back into Roy with that, you know. And he said, oh yeah, man, that's great. So we went tearing into a sort of a different approach to the song, and keeping it calm at the same time. And by the time we came to the recording, a lot of the heavier rhythm sort of had diminished.
I got up this morning, I didn't have time to do my exercises, and I was nervous, and I came down here and I thought, I don't know how to do this tune really at all. So then I thought, well, then you have to just, man, reach inside and pull it out somehow, and it's not so easy to do.
Far away across the ocean, under
I've idolized Roy Cooter for years, you know, from his first, when he only half filled the stadium to when you couldn't get tickets for him in the stadium. And he was a joy to work with. He put very much his own stamp on the song.
Well, it's a fantastic song. It really is, it really is a heartbreaking song. It pulls a lot of emotion. I don't know why, but it's the wine business about the red flowers and the waves and all that. I mean, you can see this thing happening, of course. All Irish music is intensely visual, right?
Yeah.
It's all like so atmospheric and pictorial in that we went down this road and up over that mountain and the foggy dew and the bells rang and you're always seeing pictures.
Of my
Malabar, you know, where did it come from? Nobody knows. And it's just a very old traditional song. I mean, it has a definite kick of being an Irish ballad. And I always considered it, this is going back to the 40s now when I heard it first. And they used to sing it, you know, 50, 60, maybe, I don't know how long before that. My relations. It was a song that was handed down along with many, many songs, you know. And they sang them in such a way they sounded like traditional Irish ballads. There was no guitars, no rhythms, no nothing going with them. And they really got you, and people loved them, you know. And then, you know, I presented it to Roy, and so there's a half and half, there's a meeting halfway here with Roy, kind of South Sea Island feel about it, the lovely guitar playing that he put onto it as well, gives it that fantastic, and using his floor machine, I called it, you know, the 12-foot long string instrument that I dubbed on afterwards, and it has this swish of, you know, you can hear the sea and the coming up on the shore through the sand, and it just gave it a beautiful feeling, and all my dreams of that song, what it was all about, came through once I heard the last take, you know, and mixing it down perfect.
Great time at Roy Cooter, different and set up altogether. A hell of a nice guy, terrific musician, and it was fun. I think this is how we enjoy these recordings. There's a bit of tension there, okay, but it always seems to end up that we have a bit of fun as well.
We found over the last few years that slowly but surely, like that there was a lot of Closet Chieftains fans.
Well, it's the music, basically, really, and not alone these artists, but so many people throughout the world have become interested in actual acoustic sound. They hear the actual sound of the instrument rather than it coming through some electronics.
You see, we've got a marvellous legacy of really melodic material, good melodies, and the supply never seems to run short.
But it's inevitable that you learn from any amalgamation like that.
It's far better to see how other artists work who play music you can't play, and then you develop.
But I don't think we'd ever totally drift away from what we set out to do in the first place.
But I don't know very much about this because I'm not much of a musician. My great gift's wheeling the harp case round airports. That's what I do best.
With Mark, again, went over to London and sat down, went through bits and pieces. We were actually not going to do a song at all at one stage. We were just going to do instrumental stuff. And we played various pieces. But I played him this Lily of the West, which is the one I have was the older version, original version of, you'd find it in Colm O'Loughlin's book, and goes back quite a long time. It's in a minor mode, much old traditional air, but also this particular Lily of the West is very, very similar to the air, which is the major, going into the major key, the Lakes of Pontestrain, which Paul Brady and Planxty and various other people, John Baez recorded as well. So he was familiar with that air. And he said, look, I'll use the one I'm familiar with more. So we swapped the air into the original Lily of the West song, and he went with it, but he did a great job on it.
When first I came to Ireland, some pleasure for to find. It's there I spied a damsel fair most pleasing to my mind. Her rosy cheeks and sparkling eyes like arrows pierced my breast. And I call her lovely Molly O, the lily of the west.
It was all really, really natural. There was no, there was no problems at all. And I think because it's quite a tough song, I found myself singing in a way that I never have before. Just, I didn't know whether it was ridiculous or what. I just did it. I sang it that way. And I grew up in folk clubs. I mean, after I'd been playing for 5 minutes, I was playing in folk joints in England anyway. So I'd heard a lot of that music, and I suppose it just comes out. It's in there somewhere and comes out.
The lily of the west.
Mark Knopfler, his track really appeals to me because it really reminds me of, again, the era I'm talking about, the early 60s when there were, you know, the Ludlows and the Emmett Spiceland and all the rest. And he does the Lily of the West. And I suppose Paul Brady sitting in on it helped as well, but the flavour is so authentic, so very much like you'd think Mark Knopfler was a born ballad singer, you know, folk singer, the way he approaches it. It's wonderful.
You have to hand it to Paddy. I mean, he certainly gets all these ideas. He says, hey, Mark, I've got a great idea. Now, would you like to go and play in front of the Taj Mahal? No, not really. Oh, okay. Well, no, I was thinking the pyramids, you know, or something like that. You wonder what he's going to come up with next. It's amazing that he wasn't actually standing playing on the Berlin Wall when that came down.
One I always wanted to do. I was actually going to do it with another gospel singer. I had in mind, you know, to do this version of the Foggy Dew. And when I met up with Sinead in Dublin a couple of months before the session, we were going over songs and playing tapes and talking about this and showing her this and playing her tunes on the whistle. We spent about 4 hours together just chalking, and she became really emotional and loved getting back into what she'd forgotten about, you know. So she was completely sold on everything that I suggested. And she used to sing She Moved to the Fair. That was one of her favourite songs anyway. But the old Foggy Dew was one that, you know, I turned her on to. She remembers it from school days, of course. So I gave her that feeling with the drums and again, using these big long drums. It turned out great, you know.
City fair, Rhode Island.
She's brilliant. We had a rehearsal with Sinead the day before. We went down to record, sat in. She's great. Sinead is great. Well, she's one of ourselves, if you know what I mean. She was great and just launched into it.
To me, the world is just one big oyster, and you can go places, and if you come across good music, that has been there, and you can mix your own traditional music with it. There's no problems at all. I don't find any problem. I see nothing now that's beyond us, you know, that we can't do. We've gone so far. We've achieved an enormous amount. You know, we played with all the big rock and roll people. We have got as yet to get around some of the younger, well, Sinead is young, of course, but some of the younger bands, you know, that are knocking about.
A lot of the collaborations were, like, from an artistic point of view, I think definitely work. Some of them probably don't, or maybe they're fairly immediate. But what they do is, if nothing else, they definitely broaden the music base, or the broaden the base of the band worldwide.
There will be Chieftains only records coming out as well. But this getting together with other people, it can't be avoided, because most of the time they are asking us, could they do something with us? It has reached that stage. A lot of them have approached us. Paddy would have approached others.
Well, Paddy's always scheming, you know. There's more than one idea still up his sleeve, you know.
Well, those are sort of artistic direction ideas. It's his privilege and it's his band to decide whether he wants to go to the North Pole and record with the Eskimos or not. I mean, we'll go along with anything because it's a good education for us. But he dreams the stuff up all right, because it is his band and he's the founder.
Well, I did bring them to Alaska last year. You know, I've been wanting to go to Alaska for a long time. But it's all had to be at the end of a March tour, of the only time, and nobody wanted to extend the 3 or 4 weeks, want to get back home after a grueling tour. But then we went last year. Oh, we had a great time.
Paddy is one of these fellas like that. He gets an idea, will take him over, and he'll work at it 24 hours a day if once it takes him over. And it's one of these fellas, if he gets the ball, he keeps it under his arm until he's right in front of the goal, and then he scores. And that's the way he does things. That's part of the reason why the Chieftains are where they are.
Marianne Faithfull, for instance, we always talked about doing Love Is Teasing. That was one of her great old favourite songs. And her approach to it at first was slightly different than what I had in mind. I think, you know, she was going with a bit of a rhythm into it, you know. And then I got a tape of Dolly McMahon singing it in the old style, the old traditional style. And she still wasn't convinced, but the day before she said, I'm thinking about that. I think you're right. We'll do it. So we also compromised. At the end, I put in a sort of a slow kind of a waltz as if she got up and started to dance with somebody.
I wish in vain. I wish I were a maid again. But a maid again I can never be. Until apples grow on an ivy tree.
She's a lovely lady, yeah. And very laid back and very relaxed. And I think it's a lovely song, and I think what she does it just as it should be done. Sings like a lady who knows what she's talking about too, you know.
Then love grows cold and it fades away like the morning.
These people, they open your eyes, and it's a delight to work with them. We know what we're doing. We've grown up with it, the Irish music, and we're pretty good at it. It's great to meet somebody else so good and who understands and appreciates what we're about.
There is a house in the town.
Gone over there to live, and you and the Chieftains were appearing at Carnegie Hall, and I went along to the show, and it was absolutely wonderful. I'll never forget it. And then afterwards at the Mayflower on the West Side, we were hanging out in the bar, and that was when you said to me, there is a song I'd really like you to do one day, and it's called Love is Teasing. And now finally we've managed to do it, and I'm very, very happy we did.
With my darling to the Tennessee Waltz, when an old friend I happened to see introduced him to my darling, and while they were dancing, my friend stole my sweetheart from me.
Tom, you know, it's only totally by coincidence, and I didn't even know this, that Dweezil and Amit, his sons, Frank's sons, were great fans of Tom Jones. And it's totally by coincidence that we brought Tom there to do the Tennessee Waltz.
What's your relationship with the Chieftains?
With the Chieftains?
Uh-huh.
Well, as I was saying, we did this TV show together in England.
Yeah.
And it worked out really nice.
Friends for life now.
Yeah, first time we worked together. Yeah. You know, I mean, I knew all of them, and I knew exactly what they were.
That's what we're getting at here, Tom. We want to know how'd you first meet them? Did you see Patty on the street corner and go, "Yo, man, you play the sweet whistle"? Yeah. Is that what happened?
It was something like that, yeah.
Actually, what I was trying to do was to pin down Frank into a session. I wanted to get a song from him before he died, you know. And he knew, you know, it's just no secret.
You did the session here in our father's studio. Now, mm-hmm. What was his involvement in this project?
Well, he knew the chieftains. You know, that's what they were telling me about, that they knew him well, and they used to come and record whenever they could do. So I said, that's great. You know, let's do it there then, if you feel comfortable, you know. At Frank's place, let's give it a shot.
It's the craziest whole concept.
Frank was wonderful, you know, and we could use the studio anytime we wanted to. In fact, the harp album, the Celtic harp album, our last one, which again won a Grammy, half of it was recorded there in an hour one night, you know. We were in Frank's house.
Yeah, well, Frank was in, was in the control.
And was he, like, giving you little pointers on what you should do?
No, the great thing about it was he said, you know, you just do what you do. That's it.
You know, Frank was sitting back in his chair smoking his cigarette and sort of in command, but not taking part, if you know what I mean. He was such a nice, but now and again, he's patting you. And he tipped me off about something, you know what I mean? Oh, good, thanks, Frank, you know. Okay, piano, that's this and that and the other. You know, we'd have a change of chords here or something like that, you know. He was wonderful that way.
Well, I remember something completely different. Okay, I remember him coming in here, and you had him in a headlock, and you're going, huh, Frank, huh, like that. And then that's all I remember, and then I remember, like,
someone came up behind me, and
then you were gone, and the song was finished, so I never really actually got to witness the actual recording procedure, but it went well, right?
It did go very well.
Okay.
And we had a ball, Beverly D'Angelo lived next door, and she came in, and Tom was rushing off to do the Letterman show, and he missed the, you know, we started to tell stories and drink beer, and that was the end of it. He stayed all night.
I remember
unfortunately, Frank went not too long after that, but we'd been to his home many times. Always had a great time there.
It was just such a pleasant house to go into. It was very much sort of Hollywood Hills type house, and all the trimmings that go with that, but a lovely atmosphere in the house.
Tom Jones was one of the very best. He was a highlight. He was outstandingly good. He can take a whole crowd with him. Even when there's nothing there but a microphone, I can't even get warmed up to a recording on one microphone, but it seems he can, and I understand he has a certain number of beers inside him first, and that's what warms him up, but I don't know.
It's genius.
Mm-hmm. It really turned out nice. Yeah. I mean, that's the first time I'd heard the finished thing when we heard it, because I've been waiting for it to, you know, to come over, but it really sounded like it did when we did it.
That's
you know, that's the thing that I like about it. It's live.
He's incredible, that fella. Like, I mean, he just walked in there and we just walked out, an intro, a bridge, break, whatever, outro, off we go. Many verses. Okay, right, we'll do it.
You know, they play authentic music. It's Celtic music.
Yeah.
And they're nice guys as well. But I mean, the way they do it is the key. They make it sound very loose.
Yeah.
But in fact, it's all very well rehearsed. And
they're the best at what they do.
Exactly. They're the best Celtic band in the world. So they do contribute to the world music.
I think he is very well charged with cosmic energy and personality and charisma. And he's the courage of his conviction. He's a happy fellow. He has everything he wants and everything he needs and more. And he's got a marvelous, sonorous voice.
Really, they are great musicians. And, you know, he always dug that. Professional, you know, it's professional stuff. I mean, you gotta do it right before you can get loose with something. You know what I mean? And they are, they know what they're doing. I mean, it sounds like, as we said earlier, that they're in a bar somewhere.
Yeah.
But that takes work to get that thing to sound like that.
But Tom enjoyed the whole session. And it inspired me to write this little mazurka that came afterwards, which we went jigging into the Tennessee mazurka and calling it.
Now, what's the Tennessee mazurka?
Yeah.
What the hell's a mazurka?
I think it's a some kind of dance, I think.
Is that what?
Because that's what they busted into at the end.
Yeah, but is that like the name of the dance or the rhythm? I mean, do you say, ladies and gentlemen, it's time for the mazurka? I mean, like everybody's waiting for Tom to whip out the mazurka.
Yeah, well, it could be. I mean, Patty never explained it to me. Well, he said
Patty's
that's what they.
Got to explain it to
yes, sir. Comfortable with the name Mazurka, right? It doesn't like
sounds all right to me.
Doesn't scare you.
Yeah. No, it doesn't scare me.
Like someone's couldn't say
people
it.
Are a berserker for the Mazurka. All right.
Thank you. All right.
They play everything like flawlessly, because you can sit them down and they're like, yeah, play that song, and they never make mistakes, it seems like. They just all go, no problem, Guinness,
and they're
I'll play.
They're playing
you know
some
I mean?
Hard stuff, too. I mean, hell, they play a mazurka.
Yeah, exactly.
And they play badass mazurka, let me tell you.
I think I liked them all, every one of them. I mean, I had a big decision. They were trying to persuade me to leave something off, one of the songs off, because it was just a bit long, you know, for the cassette went over the top. I could not make up my mind on any of them, you know, because every one of them to me is an occasion. You know, there's things that happened around each song that you could almost write a whole chapter about. The recording of each song.
As long as the chieftains are living and reasonably healthy to stick the travelling, they'll not stop. It's as certain as that.
As I say, I'm not bored yet. Don't think I will be, and I like travelling. I like the concert work, and that's about what our job is about, travelling and playing. So until the good health I've had lets me down, I think I'll be plugging away. Oh, we could be playing when we're 90, who knows, you know?
I mean, nothing can go on forever. The world's full of duality. You come to an end, you have a middle, you have a beginning. So they are a finite band. They're not infinite yet.
I gave it, at least I told my wife at the time, I'd give it 6 months of a try. Knowing, well, I knew it was at the back of my head that it wasn't going to end at that. I was going to give it my damnedest, you know? And I'm still at it.
The people live longest that have interest. That's the most important thing to have. Once you start losing interest, willpower evaporates, and then you go down the drain rapidly. Then tiredness sets in, and then cancer sets in, and then the doctor comes, and then they wheel you out. It's terrible.
It's very hard to say. I mean, who would have thought 30 plus years ago that the Chieftains would still be around today? Because not many groups last that long. And I don't know. I'm going to keep playing anyway until I drop.
Yeah, sure. Keep on 30 more days, whatever. So long as we can squeeze it, we get all we can out of it.
You know, I'd love it all. You know, I love the buzz. I would like more time at home, to be honest. You know, I'd love to be able to take a week, just 1 week in the year. With nothing else happening, nothing to do with music, walk up the mountains here, or dig the garden, or put down the rest of me rocks and stones that I've been trying to do for the last 2 years. I just would love to do that sometime, just a week that the phone doesn't ring. I mean, the phone rings even on Christmas Day, somebody wishing a happy Christmas, but it leads to something else, you know? And then you're back into it again, you know? But no, I wouldn't have it any other way, to be honest, you know?
But sometimes at night, where the cold wind moans in a long black veil, she cries all over my bones. She walks these hills in a long black veil. She visits my grave when
So, Derek, one final question. Is there anything you'd like to change over the last 30 years?
Not really, but I can always do with better food.
The Long Black Veil, Por Dentro, foi o que hoje vimos. Um documentário-reportagem sobre o último trabalho do grupo irlandês de Chieftains. Para a semana, voltaremos com mais música da Terra. Até lá, boa noite.